thanks. Do you know something? I checked the weather today. Turns out it's the hottest day of the year. You'd think they'd at least air condition the court. I mean, I almost dropped dead in there. All right, ladies and gentlemen, everybody's here. If you need anything, I'm right outside, just knock.
I never knew they locked the door.
Sure they locked the door. What do you think?
I don't know. It just never occurred to me.
Hey, what's that for?
Well, I figure we vote by ballot.
Great. Maybe we can get him elected senator.
How'd you like it?
I don't know, it was pretty interesting.
Yeah, I was falling asleep.
Well, I've never been on a jury before.
Really? I've been on juries, and it always amazes me how these lawyers can talk and talk and talk, even if the case is as obvious as this one. I mean, did you ever hear so much talk about nothing?
Well, I guess they're entitled.
Sure they are. Everyone deserves a fair trial. That's the system. Listen, I'm the last one to say anything against this, but I'm telling you, I think we'd be better off if we took these tough little kids and slapped them down before they make trouble, you know? Save us a lot of time and money.
How about getting started here?
Yeah, let's get this over with. We probably all have better things to do.
Well, I think we ought to take a 5-minute break. I mean, the other guy's in
the
bathroom.
Are we gonna sit in order?
I'm not sure.
Not a bad view. What'd you think of the case? Had a lot of interest for me. No dead spots, know what I mean? I'll tell you, we were lucky to get a murder trial. I figured us for an assault or a burglary, those can just be the dullest.
What an absolute waste of time.
Yeah, can you imagine sitting there 3 days straight just for this?
And that business with the knife? I mean, getting people to believe that sort of garbage.
Look, you gotta expect that. You know what you're dealing with.
Ah, I suppose so. What's the matter? Got a cold?
And how? These hot weather colds can kill you. I can hardly touch my nose.
Your horn's working now. Try your lights. That's beautiful. The fan doesn't work. Somebody take a letter to the mayor. Dear Stingy.
Let me take a look at it. It doesn't work.
I didn't get a chance to look at the newspaper today. Anything new going on?
Well, earlier I was wondering how the market closed.
I wouldn't know. Say, are you on the exchange or something?
I'm a broker.
Really? I run a messenger service, the Beck and Call Company. The name's my husband's idea, and we employ 37 people.
Oh, come on, let's get started.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's take seats.
This better be quick. I have a concert at 8. Where do you want us to sit?
Well, I figure we sit in order of jury numbers. You know, 2, 3, 4, and so on. If that's okay with you all.
What's the difference?
I think it's reasonable to sit according to number.
Let it be.
Say, what was your opinion of the prosecuting attorney?
I beg pardon?
I thought he was really sharp. I mean, the way he hammered home his points one by one in such logical sequence, it takes a good brain to do that. I was very impressed.
Yes, I think he did an expert job.
He had a lot of drive, too. Real drive.
Let's get this show on the road.
How about sitting down? Excuse me. How about sitting down?
I'm sorry.
It's pretty tough to figure, isn't it? A kid kills his father, bing, just like that.
Well, if you analyze the figures...
What figures? It's those people I'm telling you. They let their kids run wild up there. Maybe serves them right, know what I mean?
We'd like to get started here.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Now, you people can handle this any way you want. I mean, I'm not gonna set any rules for you. If you wanna talk first, then vote, that's one way. Or you can... vote first and see where you stand. Well, that's all I have to say.
I think it's customary to take a preliminary vote.
Yeah, let's vote. Who knows where we're gonna go home?
That's fine with me. Just remember, we've got a first-degree murder charge here. If we vote guilty, we send the accused to the electric chair. That's mandatory.
I think we all know that.
Come on, let's vote.
Yeah, let's see who's where.
Okay, anybody doesn't want to vote? The vote has to be 12-0, either way. That's the law. Okay, those voting guilty, raise your hands. 9, 10, 11. That's 11 guilty. Okay, not guilty? Right, that's 11-1 guilty. Now we know where we are.
Boy, oh boy, there's always one.
So, what do we do now?
Well, I guess we talk.
Boy, oh boy.
Well, look, do you really think he's innocent?
I don't know.
I mean, let's be reasonable. You sat in court and heard the same thing we did. The man's a dangerous killer. You could see it.
The man? He's 16 years old.
Well, that's old enough. He knifed his own father 4 inches into the chest.
It's obvious. I was convinced from the first day.
Well, who was it? I honestly think that this is one of those open and shut things. They proved it a dozen different ways. Would you like me to list them for you?
No.
Then what do you want?
Nothing. I just want to talk. What's there to talk about? 11 people in here agree. No one had to think twice about it except you.
Look, let me ask you a question. Do you believe his story?
I don't know whether I believe it or not. Maybe I don't.
So what'd you vote not guilty for?
There were 11 people in here who voted guilty. It's not easy for me to just raise my hand and send some boy off to die without talking about it first.
And who says it's easy for me?
No one.
What?
Just because I voted quickly? I honestly think he's guilty, and you can't change my mind if you talk for 100 years.
I'm not trying to change your mind. It's just, we're talking about somebody else's life here. We can't just decide in 5 minutes. Suppose we're wrong. Suppose we're wrong. Suppose this whole building fell on my head. You can suppose anything.
That's right. What's the difference how long this takes? If we all honestly think he's guilty, what's the difference if this takes 5 minutes?
Let's take an hour. Your concert doesn't start till 8.
Okay, be my guest.
Well, who's got something to say? How about you?
Not me.
I'm willing to put in an hour.
Great. Oh, I heard a pretty good joke last night. A horse walks into a bar, and the bartender goes, "Why the long face?"
That's not what we're sitting here for.
All right. Then you tell me, what are we sitting here for?
Maybe for no reason. I don't know. Look, this boy has been kicked around all his life. You know, living in a slum. His mother dead since he was 9. He spent a year and a half in an orphanage while his father served a jail term for forgery. That's not a very good head start. The boy's had a pretty terrible 16 years. I think we owe him a few words. That's all.
I don't mind telling you this, miss. We don't owe him a thing. He's got a fair trial, didn't he? What do you think the trial costs? He's lucky he got it. Listen, I've lived among them all my life. You cannot believe a word they say. They're born liars.
It suddenly occurs to me that you must be a very ignorant person.
What do you mean? What's he talking about?
Do you think you have a monopoly on the truth?
What are you making a federal case out of this for? How do you like this guy?
I think certain things should be pointed out to this woman.
All right, it's not Sunday. We don't need a sermon in here.
Monopoly, for goodness sakes.
If we're going to discuss this case, let's stick to the facts.
Right, we have a job to do. Let's do it. Maybe the person down there who's disagreeing could tell us why. You know, tell us what she thinks. Maybe we can show her where she's probably mixed up.
Barden, what are you doing?
Oh, this? It's a product I work on at the ad agency. Rice Pops, the breakfast with the built-in bounce. I wrote that line.
Hey, it's very catchy.
If you don't mind.
Sorry, I have this habit of doodling. Keeps me thinking clearly.
We're trying to get somewhere here. You know, we can sit here forever.
Well, here's a quick thought. The way I see it, it's up for us to convince this lady that we're right and she's wrong. So maybe if we went round the table and each took a minute or two. It's just an idea.
No, it's a good one. Suppose we go once around the table in order of jury numbers.
Anything. Let's just start it off.
Okay, that means you're first.
Oh. Well, it's hard to put into words. I think he's guilty. I thought it was obvious in the beginning. I mean, nobody proved otherwise.
Nobody has to prove otherwise. The burden of proof is on the prosecution. The defendant doesn't have to say a word. That's in the Constitution. You've heard of it.
Well, sure I've heard of it. I know what the Constitution is. What my point was, Well, the man's guilty. Well, somebody saw him do it, and...
Okay, now here's what I think, and I have no personal feelings about this. I'm talking facts. Number one, let's take the old man who lived right underneath the room the murder took place. At 10 minutes after 12, he said he heard loud noises coming from the apartment upstairs. He said it sounded like a fight. Then he heard the kid yell out, "I'm gonna kill you." A split second later, he heard the body fall. He ran to the door, looked out, saw the kid running down the stairs and out of the house. Then he called the police. They found the father with the knife in his chest.
And the coroner fixed the time of the death at around midnight.
Right. I mean, these are facts for you. You can't refute facts. Look, I'm as sentimental as the next person. I know this kid is only 16, but he still got to pay for what he did.
I'm with you, miss.
It was obvious to me, anyway, that the boy's entire story was flimsy. He claimed he was at the movies during the time of the killing, and yet, 1 hour later, he couldn't remember what films he saw or who played in them.
That's right. Did you hear that? She's absolutely right.
No one saw him go into or out of the theater.
Look, what about the woman across the street? If her testimony doesn't prove it, nothing does.
That's right. She was the one who actually saw the killing.
Let's go in order here.
Just a minute. Here's this woman who's lying in bed and can't sleep. She's dying with the heat, know what I mean? Anyway, she looks out her window and across the street, she sees the kid stick the knife into his father. The time is 12:10 on the nose. Everything fits. Look. She's known this kid all his life. His window is right opposite hers, across the L tracks, and she swore she saw him do it. Yeah.
Through the windows of a passing elevated train.
Right. This L train had no passengers on it. It was just being moved downtown. The lights were out, remember? And in court, they proved that at night, you can look through the windows of a passing L train when the lights are out and see what's happening on the other side. They proved it.
I'd like to ask you something.
Sure.
You don't believe the boy, then how come you believe the woman? She's one of them too, isn't she?
You're pretty smart, aren't you?
Hey, let's take it easy.
No! What's she so wise about? I'm telling you!
Come on now, sit down. What are you letting her get you all upset for?
Let's calm down now. Let's try and keep things peaceful in here. Whose turn is it? How about you?
I'll pass it.
That's your privilege. How about the next person?
Oh, well, I started to be convinced, you know, very early in the case. And I was looking for a motive. And that's very important, because if there's no motive, where's your case? So anyway, that testimony from those people who lived across the hallway from the boy's apartment, that was pretty powerful. Didn't they say something about an argument between the boy and the father at about 7 p.m.? I mean, I could be wrong.
It was 8 o'clock, not 7.
That's right, 8 o'clock. They heard an argument, but they couldn't hear what it was about. Then they heard the father hit the boy twice, and finally they saw the boy walk angrily out of the house. What does that prove?
Well, it doesn't exactly prove anything, it's just part of the picture. I didn't say it proved anything.
You said it revealed a motive for the killing. The prosecuting attorney said the same thing. Well, I don't think it's a very strong motive. I mean, this boy has been hit so many times in his life that violence is practically a normal state of affairs for him. I can't see two slaps in the face provoking him into committing murder.
It may have been two slaps too many. Everyone has a breaking point.
Anything else?
No.
Okay, how about the next person?
Me? Oh, I don't know. I mean, it's practically all been said already. I mean, this kid is 0-5. Look at his record. At 10, he was in children's court for throwing a rock at his teacher. 14, reform school, he stole a car. He's been arrested for mugging, and he was picked up twice for trying to slash another teenager with a knife. He's real quick with switch knives, they said. Oh yeah, this is a very fine boy.
Ever since he was 5 years old, his father beat him up regularly. He used his fist.
And so would I, a kid like that.
Wouldn't you call those beatings a motive for him to kill his father?
I don't know. It's a motive for him to be an angry kid, I'll say that.
It's the kids the way they are nowadays. Angry, hostile. You can't do anything with them. Listen, when I was his age, I used to call my father sir. That's right, sir. Do you ever hear a kid call his father that anymore?
Fathers don't seem to find it important anymore. Have you got any kids?
No, I don't. But I've got a nephew, my sister's kid. His father died several years ago, and we did everything you'd possibly do to turn that kid into a decent young man. I mean everything. And what happened? When he was 13, he got into a fight at school with a boy and nearly blinded him. So I told him straight up, you need to pull it together or you're going to be an embarrassment to your family and to your father's memory. But that's not all. When he was 16, we got into an argument. I don't remember what it was about, but he slapped me so hard across the face and nearly knocked me out. He's big, you know. Haven't seen him in 2 years. Fine young man he turned out to be. I mean, look, you work your heart out and... All right, let's get on with it.
I think we're missing the point here. This boy, let's say he is the product of a filthy neighborhood and a broken home. We can't help that. We're here to decide whether he's guilty or innocent of murder, not to go into reasons why he grew up this way. He was born in a slum. Slums are breeding grounds for criminals. I know it, and so do you. It's no secret. Children from slum backgrounds are potential menaces to society. Now, I really...
Well, you can say that again. The kids who crawl out of those places are real trash. I want nothing to do with them.
I lived in a slum all my life. I nursed that trash in a hospital 6 nights a week.
Now, wait a second here.
I used to play in a backyard that was filled with trash. Maybe it still smells
on me. Now, listen, buddy.
Now, let's be reasonable. There's nothing personal
here.
There
is something personal.
Come on now. She didn't mean you. Let's not be so sensitive.
This sensitivity, I understand.
Let's stop all the arguing. We're wasting time here. It's your turn. Let's go.
Well, I wasn't expecting a turn. I thought you all were supposed to be convincing me. Wasn't that the idea?
Check. I forgot that.
Well, what's the difference? She's the one who's keeping us here. Let's hear what she has to say.
Now listen, we decided to do this a certain way. Let's stick to what we said.
Stop being a kid, will you?
A kid? Listen, what do you mean by that?
What do you think I mean? K-I-D, kid.
What? Just because I'm trying to keep things organized? What, you want to try? Here, you take responsibility. I'll just shut up, that's all.
Listen, what are you getting so hot about? Calm down, will you?
Don't tell me to calm down. Here, here's the chair. You keep it going smooth and everything. What, you think it's a snap? Come on, Mrs. Fullman. Let's see how great you'd run the show.
Have you ever seen such a thing?
What, you think it's funny or something?
Hey, take it easy. The whole thing's unimportant.
Unimportant? You want to try it?
No, listen, you're doing a beautiful job. Nobody wants to change.
Yeah, yeah. Hang in there, you're doing fine.
Mom, let's hear from somebody.
Well, if you want me to tell you how I feel about it right now, that's all right with me.
I don't care what you do.
All right. I haven't got anything brilliant. I only know as much as you do. According to the testimony, the boy looks guilty. Maybe he is. I sat there in court for 3 days while the evidence piled up. But everybody sounded so positive that I started to get a peculiar feeling about this trial. I mean, nothing is that positive. I had some questions I would have liked to ask. Maybe they wouldn't have meant anything. I don't know, but I started to feel like the defense counsel wasn't doing his job. He let too many things go. Little things.
What little things? When these guys don't ask questions, that's because they know the answer already and they figure they'll be hurt.
Maybe. But it's also possible for a lawyer to just be plain stupid, isn't it?
You sound like you met my brother-in-law.
I tried putting myself in the boy's place. I would have asked for another lawyer, I think. I mean, if I was on trial for my life, I'd want my lawyer to tear the prosecution witnesses to shreds. Or at least to try. Look, there was one alleged eyewitness for this case. Someone else claims he heard the body fall and then saw the boy running out afterwards. There was a lot of circumstantial evidence, but really those two witnesses were the entire case for the prosecution. I mean, supposing they were wrong.
What do you mean, supposing they were wrong? What's the point of having witnesses at all?
Could they be wrong?
They stood on that stand under oath. What are you trying to say here?
They're only people. People make mistakes. Could they be wrong?
Well, no, I don't think so.
Do you know so?
Listen, no one can know a thing like this. This isn't an exact science.
That's right. It isn't.
All right, let's try to get to the point here. What about the switch knife they found in the father's chest?
Well, wait a minute. Some people haven't talked yet. Shouldn't we let them
have a turn? Look, they can talk whenever they like. Now be quiet a second, will you? Okay, what about the knife? You know the one that fine upright boy admitted buying on the night of the murder. Let's talk about that.
All right, let's talk about it. Let's get it in here to see again. Mr. Foreman?
We all know what it looks like. What are you gonna get out of seeing it again?
You brought it up.
The woman has a right to see exhibits and evidence. The knife and the way it was bought was pretty strong evidence, don't you think?
I do.
Good. Now suppose we take these facts one at a time. One, the boy admitted to going out of his house at 8 o'clock on the night of the murder after being punched several times by his father.
He didn't say punched, he said hit. There's a difference between a slap and a punch.
After being hit several times by his father. Two, the boy then went directly to a neighborhood junk shop where he bought one of those, what do you call those things?
Switch knife.
Thank you. Three, this is not just an ordinary knife. It had a very unusual carved handle. Four, the storekeeper who sold it to the boy identified it in court and said it was the only one of his kind he had ever had in stock. Five, at about 8:45, the boy ran into three of his friends in front of a diner. Am I correct so far?
Yes, you are.
You bet she is. Now listen to what she's saying. She knows what she's talking about.
The boy talked with his friends for about an hour, leaving them at 9:45. During this time, they all saw the knife. Six, each of them identified the death weapon in court as that same knife. Seven, the boy arrived home at about 10 o'clock. Now this is where the stories offered by the boy and the state begin to diverge slightly. He claims that he stayed home until 11:30 and went to one of those all-night movies. He returned home at 3:15 to find his father dead and himself arrested. Now, what happened to the knife? This is the charming and imaginative little tale the boy invented. He claims that the knife fell through a hole in his pocket sometime between 11:30 and 3:15 on his trip to the movies. Now, this is a tale, ladies and gentlemen. I think it's quite clear that the boy never went to the movies that night. No one saw him go into or out of the theater, and he couldn't even name the pictures he saw. What actually happened is this. The boy stayed home, had another fight with his father, stabbed him to death at 10 minutes after 12, and fled from the scene. He even remembered to wipe the knife clean of fingerprints. Everyone connected with the case identified the knife in court. Now, are you really trying to tell me that it really did fall through a hole in his pocket? And that someone picked it up off the streets, went to his apartment, and stabbed his father with it just to be amusing?
No, I'm saying that it's possible that the boy lost the knife and that somebody else stabbed his father with a similar knife. It's possible.
Take a look at that knife. I've never seen one like it. Neither had the storekeeper who sold it to the boy. Now, aren't you asking us to accept a pretty incredible coincidence?
I'm not asking anyone to accept it. I'm just saying that it's possible.
And I'm saying it's not possible. Wait a minute.
Let's be quiet. Where did you get that knife?
I was walking for a couple of hours last night, just thinking. I walked through the boy's neighborhood. This knife comes from a pawn shop just 4 blocks away from his house. It cost me $6.
It's against the law to buy or sell switchblade knives.
That's right. I broke the law.
Listen, you pulled a real bright trick here. Now supposing you tell us what you proved. Maybe there are 10 knives like that. So what?
Maybe there are.
So what does that mean? It's the same kind of knife. So what's that? The discovery of the age or something?
It would still have been an incredible coincidence for another person to have stabbed the father with the same kind of knife.
That's right. She's right.
I mean, the odds are a million to one. It's possible.
But not very probable.
All right, let's take seats. There's no point milling around here.
It's interesting that she'd find a knife exactly like the one the boy bought.
What's interesting? Think it proves anything?
Well, no, I was just saying
interesting.
That...
Now, wait a second. Why did the boy buy the knife in the first place?
He claims that he bought it.
He claims that he bought it as a present for a friend of his because he busted the other kid's knife by dropping it on the pavement.
That's what he said.
That's a load of crap.
The friend testified that the boy did break his knife.
Right! But how long before the killing? 3 weeks! So how come our noble lad bought this knife 1.5 hour after his father smacked him and 3.5 hours before they found it shoved up in the father's chest?
Well, they were gonna give the knife to his friend. Just had to use it for a minute, though.
You know, well, let me ask you this. If it's one of the questions I wanted to ask in court. If the boy bought the knife to use on his father, then how come he showed what would be the murder weapon to 3 of his friends just a couple hours before the killing?
Look, all of that is just talk. The boy lied and you know it.
He may have lied. Do you think he lied?
Now that's a stupid question. Of course he lied.
Do you?
You know my answer, he lied.
Do you think he lied?
I'm not sure.
You're not sure about what? No, wait a second. What are you, the kid's lawyer or something? Who do you think you are to stop cross-examining us?
Isn't that what's supposed to happen in a jury room?
Look, there's still 11 of us who think he's guilty.
What do you think you're gonna accomplish here? You're not gonna change anybody's mind. So you're gonna be stubborn and hang this jury? Go on ahead. The kid would be tried with 12 other guys and found guilty as sure as he's born.
You're probably right.
So what are you gonna do about it? Come on, we're gonna be here all night.
It's only one night. A boy may die.
Oh, brother. Anybody got a deck of cards?
I don't think she ought to make a joke out of it.
What do you want me to do?
Look, I don't understand what the whole deal with the knife has to do with anything. Somebody saw the kid kill his father. What more do you want? Listen, I've got work to do, or else I won't be able to pay my rent. Let's get done and get out of here.
The knife was very important to the district attorney. He spent one
whole month. He's the 15th assistant or something. What does he know?
All right, I think we ought to get on with it. These side arguments are only slowing us up. What about it?
You're the only one.
Listen, I have a proposition to make to all of you. I want you 11 people to vote by secret written ballot. I'll abstain. If there are still 11 votes for guilty, then I won't stand alone. We'll take a guilty verdict into the judge right now. But if anyone votes not guilty, then we'll sit and talk this thing out. That's all I have. I'm ready if you are.
Well, finally, you're behaving like a reasonable person.
Check. I'll buy that.
Yeah, let's do it.
That sounds fair. Anyone object? All right, grab your papers. Guilty. Guilty. Guilty, 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 not guilty, guilty.
Boy, oh boy, how do you like that?
And another chap flips his wig.
All right, who was it? Come on, I want to know.
Excuse me, this was a secret ballot. We agreed on this.
Secret? What do you mean secret? There are no secrets in a jury room. I know who it was. Wow, you're really something. You come in here and vote guilty like everybody else, and then this golden voice preacher over here tears your heart apart with stories about a poor little kid who just couldn't help but become a murderer. So you change your votes. If that isn't the most sickening... Why does it drop a quarter in his collection
box? Wait a minute! You can't talk to me like that! No way did she get the right to shout at me!
Hey, calm down.
Who does she think she is? I mean, you see her?
Just sit down. Forget it. She's very excitable. It doesn't matter.
You bet I'm excitable. We're trying to put a guilty man into the chair where he belongs, and all of a sudden somebody is telling us fairy tales, and we're listening!
Hey, take it easy.
What do you mean, take it easy? Do you want to see a poor murderer walking the streets? Let's give him his knife back. Make it easier for him.
Then stop all the yelling. Who's got something constructive to say?
Pardon, I would just like to say that I've always thought in this country a person was entitled to have unpopular opinions.
Let's stick to the subject. What made you change your vote?
He didn't change his vote. I did. Would you like me to tell you why?
No, I would not like you to tell me why.
Well, I'd like to make it clear anyway, if you don't mind.
Do we have to listen to this?
Hey, look, the guy wants to talk.
Thank you. This woman has been standing alone against us. She doesn't say the boy is not guilty. She just isn't sure. Well, it isn't easy to stand against the ridicule of others. She gambled for support, and I gave it to her. I respect her motives. The boy on trial is probably guilty, but I want to hear more. For the time being, the vote stands too. Hey, I'm talking here. You have no right to just walk.
She can't hear you. She never will.
Well, if the speech is over, maybe we can go on.
I think we ought to take a break. Someone's in there. We ought to wait for her.
Looks like we're really hung up here. I'll tell you, that whole deal with the cripple was really unexpected. Just wish I knew how we could break this up.
Yeah. Look, I was a little excited. You know how it is. I didn't mean to get nasty or anything.
He's guilty for sure. There's not a doubt in the whole world. He should have been done already. Listen, I don't care, you know. It beats working. You think he's innocent?
I don't know. It's possible.
I don't know you, but I'm betting you've never been wronger in your life. You ought to wrap it up. You're wasting your time.
Suppose you were the one on trial.
Well, I'm not used to supposing. I'm just a working guy. My boss, this is supposing. But I'll try one. Supposing you talk us all out of this and the kid really did knife his father.
Take seats.
Looks like we'll be here for dinner.
Let's get down to business. Who wants to start it off?
Well, I'd like to make a point. Pardon me.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No, that's all right, go ahead.
Well, this is probably a small point, but anyway, the boy had a motive for the killing, you know, the beatings and all. So if he didn't do it, who did? Who else might have had a motive? That's my point. I mean, nobody goes out and kills someone without a motive, right? Not unless he's just plain nuts.
As far as I'm aware, we're supposed to decide whether or not the boy on trial is guilty beyond reasonable doubt. We're not concerned with anyone else's motives. That's a job for the police.
Very true, but we can't help letting the only motive we know of creep into our thoughts, can we? And we can't help asking ourselves who else might have had a motive. Logically, these things follow. This gentleman asked a reasonable question. If it wasn't the boy, then who was it?
Joseph Stalin.
Oh, you're talking about the man I love.
If you haven't got anything constructive to add, I suggest you listen.
Okay, I'm sorry. I was just trying to let off some steam. Go ahead.
Maybe you can tell me. Who else might have killed the father?
I don't know. I mean, the boy's father wasn't exactly a model citizen. The boy's lawyer outlined his background in his closing statement. He was in prison once. He was known to be a compulsive gambler and a pretty consistent loser. He spent a lot of time in neighborhood bars and would often get into fights after a couple drinks, usually over a woman. He was a tough, cruel, primitive kind of man who never held a job for longer than 6 months in his life. So here are a few possibilities. He could have been murdered by one of the many men he spent time with in prison. By a bookmaker. By a man he'd beaten up. By a woman he'd picked up. By any one of the people he was known to hang out with.
Boy, oh boy, that's the biggest load of crap that I've ever... Listen, we know what the father was a bum. What has that got to do with anything?
I didn't bring it up. I was just asked who else might have killed the father. I gave my answer.
That woman over there asked a direct question.
Look, suppose he answered this for me. The old man said he heard the kid yell out, "I'm gonna kill you." A split second later, he heard the body fall. When he ran to the door, he saw the kid running out of the house. Now, what does that all mean to you?
I was wondering just how clearly the old man could have heard the boy's voice through the ceiling.
He didn't hear it through the ceiling. His window was open and so was the window upstairs. It was a hot night, remember?
But the voice still came from another apartment. It's not easy to identify a voice, especially a shouting one.
He identified and caught. He picked the boy's voice out of five others, blindfolded.
That was just an ambitious district attorney putting on a show. Look, the old man knows the boy's voice very well. They've lived in the same building for years. But to identify it positively from the apartment downstairs, isn't it possible that he could have made a mistake? That maybe he thought the boy was upstairs and just automatically decided that the voice he heard was the boy's voice?
That's idiotic. Sure he could have heard it.
Do you think so?
The old man said he heard the kid yell it out. That's enough for me.
I don't think he could have heard it.
Yeah, maybe he didn't, you know, with the yell noise.
What are you people talking about?
Well, it sounds so ridiculous.
You're crazy. Why should he lie? What's he got to gain?
Attention, maybe.
You keep coming up with these bright sayings. Why don't you send one to the newspaper? They might pay you for it.
Hey, what are you talking to him like that for? Go ahead, you have a right to speak.
It's just that I looked at him for a very long time. This was a very old man, and he had a torn jacket and was very slow to stand. I mean, he could come into court like that. He was dragging his left leg and trying to hide it because he was ashamed. I think I know him better than anyone in here. This is a quiet, frightened, insignificant old man who has been nothing all his life, who has never had recognition, his name in the newspapers. Nobody knows him. Nobody quotes him. Nobody seeks his advice after 75 years. It's a very sad thing to be nothing. A man like this needs to be listened to be recognized, to be quoted just once. This is very important. It would be so hard for him to recede into the background.
Well, if that isn't the most fantastic story that I've ever heard, how can you make up a thing like that, huh? What do you know about it?
People, this case is based on a reasonable and logical progression of facts. Let's keep it there.
Facts may be colored by the personalities of the people who present them.
Anyone want a cough drop?
I'll take one.
Say what you like, I just don't see how anyone can think the boy's not guilty.
Another thing I wanted to talk about. I think we already proved that the old man couldn't have heard the boy say,
What do you mean proved? What are you talking about?
Supposing that he did actually hear him say, I'm going to kill you. I mean, this phrase, how many times have we all said it? Probably hundreds. I could kill you for that, darling, and if you do that once more, Junior, I'm going to kill you. We say it all the time. It doesn't mean we're actually going to kill somebody.
Wait a minute. What are you trying to give us here? The phrase was, I'm going to kill you. And the boy screamed it out from the top of his lungs. Don't tell me he didn't mean it. Anybody says a thing like that the way the boy said it, they mean it.
Well, let me ask you this. Do you really think the boy would shout out a thing like that for the whole neighborhood to hear? I don't. He's much too bright for that.
Bright? He's a common ignorant slob. He don't even speak good English.
Excuse me, he doesn't even speak good English.
I'd like to change my vote to not guilty.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
The vote is 9-3 in favor of guilty.
Well, this isn't the living end. Listen, you know you ought to write for the Amazing Detective Monthly. You'd make a fortune. Now you, what are you basing this on? Stories that she made up? Listen, there are facts staring you right in the face. Every single one of them says this kid killed his own man. His own lawyer didn't believe, and you can see it. This kid deserves a chair.
Does he? It's happened before that someone's been convicted of murder and executed, and then years later someone else confesses to the crime. Sometimes the facts that are staring you in the face are wrong.
I was talking to him, not you. Listen, this kid had a lawyer, didn't he? The lawyer presented his case. How come you've got so much to say?
Because the lawyer was court appointed.
So what does that mean?
Well, it could mean a lot of things. It could mean he didn't want the case. It could mean he resented even being appointed. It's the kind of case that brings him nothing. No money, no glory, not even a good chance of winning. He'd really have to believe in his client to stand a fighting chance, and as you pointed out a second ago, he obviously didn't.
Of course he didn't. I mean, who would? Come on already, look at the time.
Pardon, but I have made some notes here.
Notes, yes.
I would please like to say something. I have been listening very carefully, and it seems to me that she has some very good points to make. We assume that the boy committed murder, that he stabbed his father in the chest and ran away. This was at about 10 minutes after 12. Now, how was the boy caught by the police? He came back home around 3 o'clock or so and was captured by two detectives in the hallway of his house. Now, my question is, if he really had killed his father, why would he come back home 3 hours later?
Look,
wouldn't he be afraid of getting caught?
He came back home to get his knife. It's not very nice to leave knives sticking around in people's chests.
Yeah. Especially relatives.
The boy knew that there were people who could identify the knife as the one he just bought. He had to get it before the police did.
But if he knew the knife could be identified, why did he leave it there in the first place?
Well, I think we can assume that the boy ran out in a state of panic after killing his father. And then when he finally calmed down, he realized he had left the knife there.
But then it depends on your definition of panic. You see, the boy was calm enough to see to it that there were no fingerprints left on the knife. Now, where did this panic start and where did it end?
Look, you can forget all the other stuff. The boy still came back home to dig out his knife and get rid of it.
3 hours later?
Sure, 3 hours later.
If I were the boy and I had killed my father, I would not have come back home 3 hours later. I would be afraid that the police would be there. I would stay away, knife or no knife.
Look, you voted guilty, didn't you? What side are you on?
I don't have to be loyal to one side or the other. I'm simply asking questions.
Well, look, this is just off the top of my head. But if I was the boy and I'd, you know, done the stabbing and everything, I'd take a chance and go back for the knife. I'll bet he figured no one had seen him and the body probably wasn't even discovered yet. After all, it was the middle of the night. He probably thought no one would find the body till the next day.
Pardon, here is my whole point. The woman testified that a moment after she saw the killing, that is, a moment after the L train went by, she let out a scream and went to telephone the police. Now the boy must certainly have heard something and known that somebody saw the killing. I just don't think that he was the murderer and he would come back home if he had been the murderer.
2 points. One, in his state of panic, he may not have even heard the scream. Perhaps it wasn't very loud. 2, if he did hear it, he may not have connected it with his own act. Remember, the boy lived in a neighborhood where screams were fairly commonplace.
Right, there's your answer. Maybe, maybe he did stab his father, did run out in a panic, did calm down 3 hours later to come back and get his knife, risking being caught by the police. I mean, maybe all of this is so, but maybe it's not. I think we have enough doubt to make us wonder whether or not the boy was there at all during the hours the murder took place.
What do you mean, doubt? Well, what are you talking about? Didn't the old man see the kid running out of the house? She's twisting the facts, I'm telling you. Did or didn't the old man see the kid running out of the house? Well, did he or didn't he?
He says he did.
He says, boy, oh boy, how do you like that? Okay, did or didn't the woman across the street see the kid kill his father? She says she did. You people are making out like it don't matter what people say. What you want to believe, you believe. And what you don't want to believe, you don't. Now what kind of way is that? What do you think these people get up on the witness stand for? Their health? I'm telling you people, the facts are being changed around here. Witnesses are being doubted and there's no reason for it.
Witnesses can make mistakes.
Sure, when you want them to, they do.
Let's hold down the yelling.
You keep saying that. Maybe what we need is a little yelling here. These guys are going off every which way. Did hear the scream? Didn't hear the scream. What does it matter? There are little details. You're missing the bigger picture. I mean, all of a sudden, everyone
I'd
is going
off. I'd like to call for
Listen.
Another vote.
I'm
There's
talking
There's another
here.
Vote called for. How about taking your seats?
What are we going to gain by voting again?
I don't know. She asked.
I've never spent so much time on nothing.
But it only takes a second.
Okay, I guess the fastest way is to find out who's voting not guilty. All right, those voting not guilty, raise your hand. Still the same. 1, 2, 3, not guilty, 9 guilty.
So where are we now? I'm telling you, we can yakety-yak till next Tuesday. Where is this getting us?
Pardon, I vote not guilty.
Oh, brother. Now listen, what are you talking about? I mean, we're all going crazy in here or something. This kid is guilty. Why don't you pay attention to the facts?
The vote is 8-4 in favor of guilty.
I mean, everybody's heart is starting to bleed for this punk little kid like the president just declared it. Love your unprivileged kid week or something. Listen, I'd like you to tell me why you changed your vote. Come on, give me reason.
I don't have to defend my decision to you. I have a reasonable doubt in my mind.
What reasonable doubt? That's nothing but words. Look, the kid just decided isn't guilty was seen ramming this thing into his own father. Well, look at it, Mrs. Reasonable Doubt.
That's not the knife. Don't you remember?
Brilliant. This is crazy. Listen, what about the old man? Are we not supposed to believe that he got up, ran to the door, and see the kid tearing down the stairs 15 seconds after the killing? That he only said that to be important? I mean, what's the point?
Wait, did the old man say he ran to the door?
ran, walked. What's the difference? He got there.
He said he ran to the door. At least I think he did.
Well, I don't know what he said, but I don't see how he could have run to the door.
He said he went from his bedroom to the front door. That's enough, isn't it?
Wait a minute. Where was his bedroom again?
Down the hall somewhere. I thought you remember everything. Don't you remember that?
No. Mr. Foreman, I'd like to see a diagram of the apartment, please. Oh, why don't we just have them run the trial over again so you can get everything straight?
Mr. Foreman!
I heard you.
All right, what's this for? How come you're the only one in the room who wants to see exhibits all the time?
I want to see this one too.
And I want to stop wasting time.
If we're going to start wading through all that business about where the
body
was found.
Not unless somebody else wants to. I just want to see if a very old man who drags one leg behind him when he walks because he had a stroke last year can get to his bed from his bed to his front door in 15 seconds.
He said 20 seconds.
He said 15.
Now he said 20. What are you trying to distort?
He said 15.
How does he know how long 15 seconds is? You can't judge that kind of thing.
He said 15 seconds. He was very positive about it.
He's an old man. You saw him. Half the time was confused. How could he be positive about anything?
I still don't see what you're gonna prove here. The man said he saw the boy.
Let's see if the details bear him out. May I? Now, this is the diagram of the apartment in which the killing took place. The old man's apartment is directly beneath it and exactly the same. Here's the L-line, bedroom, bathroom, living room, kitchen, and here is the hall. This is the front door and these are the stairs. Now, the old man says he was lying in bed when he heard the body fall. He says he got up out of bed, walked to his bedroom door, down the hall, and opened the front door just in time to see the boy racing down the stairs. Am I right so far?
Correct.
Now, the old man's bed was by his window. It's 12 feet to get from his bed to his bedroom door. The hall is 43 feet 6 inches. Now, he would have had to gotten out of bed, walked 12 feet to his bedroom door, 43 feet down the hall, and opened the front door all in 15 seconds. Do you think he could have done it?
Sure, he could have done it.
He can only walk very slowly. They had to help him into the witness chair.
You make it sound like a long walk. It's not.
For an old man with a stroke, it's a long walk.
Look, this is the bed.
What's going on here?
I want to try this thing out. See how long it took him. This is the bed. Now, it's 12 feet to get from his bed to his bedroom door. So I'll pace that out.
You're crazy. You can't recreate a thing like that.
I'd like to see it.
Okay, this is the bedroom door. Now, the hall is a little bit over 43 feet, so I'll walk to the end of the room and then to the door.
This is absolutely insane. What's the idea of wasting everyone's time here?
According to you, it'll only take 15 seconds. 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43. Can I have a chair, please? This is the old man's front door. It was chain locked according to his testimony. Now, does anyone have a watch with a second hand?
Oh, I have.
Okay. Stamp your foot when you want me to start. That'll be the body falling. Tie me from there.
Oh, I've never seen anything like this my whole life.
Okay, I'm ready.
Come on, let's go!
I want to wait until the second hand reaches 60. Okay, go.
Come on, step it up! He walked twice as fast as that!
This is, I think, even faster than the old man walked in the courtroom.
If you want me to go faster, I will. Okay, stop.
Right.
What's the time?
32 seconds exactly.
32 seconds?
No. Here's what I think happened. I think the old man heard the argument between the boy and his father a couple hours earlier. Then, while lying in bed, he heard the body fall and the woman's screams and tried to get to the front door, just in time to hear the boy running down the stairs. He assumed it was the boy.
Assumed? Now listen to me, you people. I've seen all kinds of dishonesty in my days, but this little display takes the cake. I've had enough. What is wrong with every one of you? This kid is guilty. He's got to burn. We're letting him slip through our fingers here.
Slip through our fingers? What are you? No. Ever since we walked into this room, you've been behaving like a self-appointed public avenger.
I'm telling you now, shut up.
You want to see this boy die because you personally want it, not because of the fact.
Shut up!
You're a sadist!
Shut up! You don't know what you're talking about! Let go! I'll kill her! I'll kill her!
You don't really mean you'll kill me, do you?
Is everything all right, ladies and gentlemen? I heard some noise.
No, it's just fine. Just a little argument, that's all. We're finished with this.
What are you staring at?
Well, I suppose someone should start us off.
Let's stop arguing for 2 minutes in here. Can't we stick to the subject?
There's something I would like to talk about if you people don't mind. An important point for the prosecution was that the boy, after claiming he was at the movies during the hours the killing took place, couldn't remember the names of the pictures he saw or who played in them. This lady has pointed this out in here several times.
That's correct. It was the only alibi the boy offered, and he himself couldn't back it up with any evidence at all.
Now, putting yourself in the boy's place, if you can, do you think you'd be able to remember details after an upsetting experience such as being struck in the face by your father?
I do, if there are any important details to remember.
According to the police testimony in court, the police questioned the boy in the kitchen of his apartment while the body of his father was lying in the bedroom. Do you think you'd be able to remember details under such circumstances?
I do.
Under great emotional stress.
Under great emotional stress.
He named the pictures in court. He named the movies he saw and the pictures to people who played in them.
Yes, his lawyer took great pains to bring that out. He had 3 months from the night of the murder to the day of the trial in which to memorize them. I'll take the testimony of the policeman who interrogated him right after the murder, when he couldn't remember a thing about the movies, great emotional stress or not.
I'd like to ask you a personal question.
Go ahead.
Where were you last night?
I was home.
What about the night before last?
Come on, what is this?
It's all right. I went from the court to my office and stayed there till 8:30. Then I went straight home to bed.
And the night before that?
That was Tuesday. Tuesday was the night of the bridge tournament. I played bridge.
And Monday night?
When you get her down to New Year's Eve 1940, you let me know.
Monday night. Monday night, my husband and I went to the movies.
What did you see?
The Scarlet Circle. It's a very clever whodunit.
What was the second feature?
The Remarkable Mrs. Something. Mainbridge? No, Bainbridge. The Remarkable Mrs. Bainbridge.
Excuse me, I saw that. It's actually called The Amazing Mrs. Bainbridge.
The Amazing Mrs. Bainbridge. Yes, I think that's right.
Who was in The Amazing Mrs. Bainbridge?
Barbara Long. She's a dark, very pretty girl. Barbara Lang. Lane. Something like that.
And who else?
Well, listen, it was a very inexpensive second feature with
you weren't characters. Under any emotional strain, were you?
No, I was not.
I think the point is made.
Big point.
I think it is a big point.
What? Just because she couldn't remember the name of some two-bit movie star? Well, I guess that proves that the kid was at the movies.
No, but it indicates that no one could prove he wasn't. He may have been at the movies and forgotten what he saw. It's possible. If it's perfectly normal for this woman to forget a few details, then it's also possible for the boy. Being a kid murderer isn't supposed to give you an infallible memory.
You can talk till your tongue is dragging on the floor. The boy's guilty, period. Know what I mean, my friend? Now, who's got those cough drops?
Oh, they're all gone, my friend.
What time is it?
5 to 8.
There goes your concert.
Say, could I see that knife for a second?
Well, we're so tied up 6 to 6. Who's got any suggestions?
Well, there's something I'd like to say. It's been bothering me for a while, and as long as we're all, you know, stuck here. Well, there was that whole business with the knife and the stab wound and how it was made. The downward angle of it, you know?
Don't tell me we're gonna start with that. They went over it and over it.
Well, I know they did, but I just don't quite go along with it. See, the boy is 5 feet 7 inches tall, and his father was 6'2", and that's a difference of 7 inches. It's a very awkward thing to stab down to the chest of a person who's more than half a foot taller than you are.
Give me that. Look, you're not gonna be satisfied till you see it again. So I'll give you a demonstration. Somebody get up. Okay. Now watch this. I don't want to have to do it again. I'm 6 or 7 inches shorter than you, right?
That's right. Maybe a bit more.
All right, let it be more.
Help!
With you. Now calm down. Nobody's hurt, right?
No, nobody's hurt.
All right. Now take a look at it. There's your angle. Down and in. That's how I stab a taller man in the chest, and that's how it was done. Now go ahead and tell me I'm wrong.
Down and in. I guess there's no argument.
Wait a minute, give me that. I hate these things, I've seen them a lot.
Have you seen them used in fights?
A lot in my backyard. Switch knives came in a neighborhood I lived in. Funny I wasn't thinking of it. I guess you try to forget those types of things. You don't use this kind of knife that way. You have to hold it like this to release the blade. In order to stab downward, you have to change a grip.
How do you use it?
Underhanded. Like that. Anyone who used a switch knife never used it in any other way.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure. That's why they're made like that.
Well, we all agree that the boy was pretty handy with a switch knife, right?
Right.
Do you think he could have made the kind of wound that killed his father?
Not with the experience he had with those things, no. He would go for the underhanded.
How do you know? What, were you in the room when the father was killed?
No, and neither was anyone else.
You're giving me a lot of mumbo jumbo here. I don't believe it. What do you think?
I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
I don't know, okay?
How about you?
Listen, I'm getting a little sick of all this yakking getting us nowhere, so I'm gonna break us up. I'm changing my vote to not guilty.
You're what?
You heard me. I've had enough.
What do you mean you've had enough? That's no answer.
Listen, you, just worry about yourself.
No. She's right. That is not an answer. What kind of person are you? You've been sitting here with everyone else and voting guilty, and now you change your vote because you say you're sick of all the talking here? You can't play like this with a human being's life. It's a terrible and ugly thing to do. Don't you care?
You can't talk like that to me.
I can't talk like that to you. If you want to vote not guilty, then do it because you believe he's not guilty, not because you're sick of all the talking. And if you still believe that he is guilty, then vote that way.
Now listen.
What, guilty or not guilty?
I told you, not guilty.
Why?
I don't have to explain myself to you.
You do have to say it. Why?
I don't think he's guilty.
Mr. Foreman, I'd like to call for another vote.
Okay, there's another vote called for. I guess the fastest way is a show of hands. Anyone object? Those voting not guilty, raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Those voting guilty, raise your hand. 9-3 in favor of not guilty.
I don't understand you people. Okay, let's talk facts. These people are born to lie. Now, that's just how they are, and no intelligent person's gonna tell me otherwise. I mean, take a look at them. They're different. They think different. They act different. Well, for instance, they don't need any big excuse to kill someone. Smart guy. Look at him. And then they're drunk. And all of a sudden, bang! Somebody is lying dead in the gutter. Now, nobody's blaming them for it. That's just how they are. Violent. You know what I mean? Human life don't mean as much to them as it does to us. Where are you going? While you're in there, maybe you should clean out your ears. Maybe you'll hear something. Listen. They're drinking and fighting all the time. And if somebody gets killed, so somebody gets killed. They don't care. Family don't mean anything to them. I mean, they breed like animals. Fathers, mothers, that don't mean anything. Okay, there are some good things about them. I've known some who are okay, but that's the exception.
Do you know you're a sick person?
Sick?
Why don't you sit down?
You crippled fool! No, who is he to tell me sick? Take a look at him! He can hardly stand up! Listen, I'm speaking my piece here and you're gonna—
Maybe if you just quieted down—
I will not like to quiet down! There is not one of them who's any good! Do you hear that? Not one! Now let me lay this out for you, ignorant idiots! You're so smart! We're facing a danger here, do you know that? These people are wild animals. That's right, they are. Don't look at me like that. These people are dangerous. We are living in a dangerous time. If we don't watch our backs, if we don't smack them down whenever we can, they're gonna own us.
Oh, shut up!
Now you listen to me here. These people are vicious, violent, ignorant, and they will cut us up. That's their intent, to cut us up. This boy on trial, we got him. That's one at least. I say, get to his kind before his kind gets to us. I don't care about the law. They don't. Why should I? No, I'm telling you.
I've heard enough. Now you stop all this right now.
Now you listen to me here.
We've heard enough. Now sit down and don't open your filthy mouth again.
And this is a safeguard that holds enormous value in our system. No jury can declare a man guilty unless it's sure. We nine still can't understand how you three are so sure. Maybe you can tell us.
I'll try. You've made some excellent points. The last one, in which you argued that the boy wouldn't have made that kind of overhand stab that killed his father, was very persuasive. But I still believe the boy is guilty of murder. There's the testimony of the woman across the street who saw the murder committed.
As far as I'm concerned, that's the most important testimony of the whole case.
Now let's talk about this woman for a minute. She said that she went to bed at about 11 o'clock. Her bed was right next to the window, and she could look out across her window and see directly into the boy's window across the L tracks. She tossed and turned for over an hour, unable to sleep. Finally, at 10 minutes after 12, she rolled over and saw the boy stab his father through the windows of the passing L train. She said that the lights went out directly after the killing, but that she got a good look at the boy in the act of stabbing his father. As far as I can see, this is an unshakable testimony.
That's what I mean. That's the whole case.
What do you think? What about you?
Well, I don't know. There's a lot of evidence to sift through. This is a pretty complicated business.
Frankly, I don't see how we can vote for acquittal.
It's difficult to get everything in order, you know?
You can forget all the other evidence. The woman saw him do it. What else do you need?
Well, maybe.
Let's vote on it.
All right, there's another vote called for. Anyone object?
I'm changing my vote. I say the boy's guilty.
Anybody else? The vote is 8-4.
What makes you think that this is a personal triumph?
I'm the competitive type, okay? Now here's what I think. I think we're a hung jury. Let's take it into the judge.
You didn't want a hung jury before.
I want it now.
Maybe we can discuss setting some sort of time limit. Someone before mentioned 10 o'clock. I think that's a good time in which we might begin to decide whether we're a hung jury or not. Right now the time is...
Quarter after nine.
Like I said, 10 o'clock might be a good time to discuss whether or not we're a hung jury.
Don't you feel well?
I feel perfectly well, thank you. As I was saying, does anyone think that that's a good idea?
The reason I asked was because you're rubbing your nose like, I'm sorry for interrupting, but you made a gesture that reminded me of...
Do you mind? I'm trying to settle something here.
I think this is important.
Very well.
Can you see your watch without your glasses?
Not too clearly. Why?
Well, what do you do at night when you wake up and you want to see what time it is?
What are you talking about? I put on my glasses and look at the clock.
You don't wear your glasses to bed?
Are you crazy? Nobody wears glasses to bed. What's all this about?
Well, I was just thinking. The woman who testified she saw the killing wears glasses. Well, she wouldn't wear them to bed, would she?
I didn't think about that.
There are 12 people focusing on this case here. 11 of us didn't think of it either. I mean, I think it's logical to say that the woman wasn't wearing her glasses while she was tossing and turning, trying to fall asleep.
How did you know?
I don't know. I'm just guessing. I'm also guessing that she didn't put on her glasses before she rolled over casually to look out her window. And she herself said that the lights went off a split second later. She couldn't have had time to put on her glasses then.
Wait a second.
And here's another guess. Maybe she honestly thought that she saw the boy stab his father. I say all she saw was a blur.
How do you know? How does she know all these things? You don't know what kind of glasses she wore. Maybe she was farsighted. What do you know about it?
All I know is that the woman's eyesight is in question now.
She had to identify a person 60 feet away, in the dark, without glasses.
Yeah, you can't just send someone off to die on evidence like that.
Don't give me that.
Isn't it possible that she was wrong?
No.
It's not possible.
No, it's not possible.
Is it possible?
Well, I think so. I say the boy's not guilty.
Do you still think he's guilty?
Yes, I think he's guilty. But I couldn't care less. You idiots do whatever you want.
How do you vote?
Not guilty. Do whatever you want.
You're the worst kind of... I think he's guilty.
Does anyone else think he's guilty?
No, I'm convinced.
What's the matter with you?
I now have a reasonable doubt.
It's 11-1.
Well, what about all the other evidence? The stuff, the knife, the whole business.
Well, you said we could forget all the other evidence.
You're alone.
I don't care whether I'm alone. It's my right.
It's your right.
Well, what do you want? I think he's guilty.
We want your argument.
I already gave you my argument.
Well, we're not convinced. We'd like to hear them again. We can take as long as you need.
Everything. Every single thing that came out in the courtroom, but I mean everything, says he's guilty. Do you think I'm an idiot or something? You lousy bunch of bleeding hearts. You're not going to intimidate me. I'm entitled to my own opinion. I can sit in this room for a year. Somebody say something. Why don't you take this stuff about the old man? The old man who lived there and heard everything. Or take this stuff about the knife. What, just because she found a like it? The old man saw him right there on the stairs. What's the difference how many seconds it took? Honestly, what's the difference? The knife falling through a hole in his pocket? You can't prove that he didn't get to the door. Sure, you can haul around the room all you want, but you can't prove it. I'm telling you, every single thing that came out of the courtroom has been turned and twisted in here. And that business with the glasses? How do you know the one didn't have them on? The one who testified in court? Well, what do you want? That's it. That's the whole case! That phrase about hearing the boy yell, the phrase was, I'm going to kill you! That's what he said! To his own father! I don't care what kind of man that was! That was his father! Look, I know him! What they're like, what they do to you, how they kill you every single day! Don't you see? How come I'm the only one who sees? I can feel the knife going in!
This isn't your nephew. The boy's somebody else.
Let him live.
We have a verdict.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, take your seats in the jury box.